I hope what I am going to say now will meet most of the points raised by you in our discussions. Anicca, Dukkha and Anatta are the three essential elements in Buddha's teaching. If you know Anicca truly, you know Dukkha also as a sequel, and Anatta as the ultimate truth. It takes time to understand the three together. Anicca is, of course, the essential factor which must be first experienced and understood by practice. A mere reading of the books on Buddhism or book knowledge of Buddha Dhamma will not be enough for the understanding of true Anicca, because the experiential aspect will be missing. It is only through experience and understanding of the nature of Anicca as an ever-changing process within your very self that you can understand Anicca in the way Buddha would like you to understand. This understanding of Anicca can be developed, as in the days of Buddha, by persons who have no book knowledge whatsoever of Buddhism. To understand Anicca, one must follow strictly and diligently the Eightfold Noble Path, which is divided into three steps of Sila, Samadhi and Vinaya. Sila, or virtuous living, is the base for Samadhi, control of mind to one-pointedness. It is only when Samadhi is good that one can develop Vinaya. So Sila and Samadhi are the prerequisites for Vinaya. By Vinaya is meant the understanding of Anicca, Dukkha and Anatta through the practice of Vipassana. Whether a Buddha has arisen or not, this practice of Sila and Samadhi are present in the world of mankind. In fact, they are the common denominator of all religious faith. They are, however, not the means for the end, that is, the end of suffering. In his search for this end of suffering, Prince Siddhartha found this out, and he worked his way through to find the path which will lead to the end of suffering. After solid work for 6 years, he found the way out, became completely enlightened, and then taught men and gods to follow the path which leads them to the end of suffering. In this connection, I should like to explain that each action, either by deed, word or thought, leaves behind a force of action, sankhara or karma in popular term, which goes to the credit or debit account of the individual according as the action is good or bad. There is therefore accumulation of sankhara or karma with everyone, which becomes the source of supply of energy to sustain life, which invariably is followed by suffering and death. It is by the development of power inherent in the understanding of Anicca, Dukkha and Anatta that one is able to rid oneself of sankhara, which becomes accumulated in one's own personal account. This process begins with the true understanding of Anicca, while further accumulations for fresh actions and reductions for the supply of energy to sustain life are taking place simultaneously from time to time and day to day. It is therefore a matter of a lifetime or more to get rid of all one's own sankhara or karma. He who has got himself rid of all sankharas or karma come to the end of suffering, because by them there is no remainder of his sankhara to give the necessary life energy to sustain him in any form of life. This end of the suffering is reached by the Buddha and the Arhats on the termination of their lives when they passed into pre-Nirvana. For us today who take to Vipassana meditation, it should suffice if we can understand Anicca very well and reach the stage of an Ariya, a Sotapatti who will not live more than 7 lives to come to this end of suffering. This Anicca, which opens the door to the understanding of Dukkha and Anatta and then leads to the end of suffering eventually, can be encountered only through a Buddha, or after he has passed away, through his teaching, for so long as that relating to the Eightfold Noble Path and the 37 factors of enlightenment, that is body, back here, remains intact and available to the aspirant. For progress in Vipassana meditation, a student must keep knowing Anicca as continuously as possible. The Buddha's advice to monks is that they shall try to maintain the awareness of Anicca or Dukkha or Anatta in all postures, whether sitting or standing or walking or lying down. The continuity of awareness of Anicca and so of Dukkha and Anatta is the secret of success. The last word of Buddha just before he breathed his last and passed away into Mahaprinibbana was, decay or Anicca is inherent in all component things. Work out your own salvation with diligence. This is in fact the essence of all his teachings during the 45 years of his lifetime. If you will keep up the awareness of Anicca that is inherent in all component things, you are sure to reach the goal in the course of time. In the meanwhile, as you develop in the understanding of Anicca, your insight into what is true of nature will become greater and greater. So much so that eventually you will have no doubt whatsoever of the three characteristics of Anicca, Dukkha and Anatta. It is then only that you are in a position to go ahead for the goal in view. Now that you know Anicca is the first essential factor, you should try to understand what Anicca is with real clarity and as extensively as possible so as not to get confused in the course of practice or discussion. The real meaning of Anicca is impermanence or decay. That is the inherent nature of impermanence and decay in everything that exists in this universe, whether animate or inanimate. To make my work of explanation easy for the present day generation, I might draw attention to the opening sentences of the chapter Atomic Contents in the book Inside the Atom by Isaac Asimov, and also to a portion of the contents at page 159 of the book about chemical reactions going on at the same time in all parts of the body of a living creature such as a human being. This should be sufficient to bring home the point of view that all things, different as they were, are made of tiny particles called atoms. These atoms have been proved by science to be in a state of arising and dissolution or change. We should accordingly accept the concept of Buddha that all component things are subject to change, decay or Anicca. But in expounding the theory of Anicca, Buddha started with the behavior which makes matter, and the matter as known to Buddha is very much smaller than the atom which the science of today has discovered. Buddha made it known to his disciples that everything that exists in this universe, whether animate or inanimate, is composed of kalapas, very much smaller than atoms, each dying out simultaneously as it becomes. Each kalapa is a mass formed of the eight nature elements, namely Pathavi, Abho, Tejo, Vayo, Vanna, Gandha, Rasa and Oja. The first four are called material qualities, which are predominant in a kalapa. The other four are merely subsidiaries, which are dependent upon and born out of the former. A kalapa is the minutest particle in the physical plane, still beyond the range of science of today. It is only when the eight nature elements, which have merely the characteristic of behavior, are together that the entirety of a kalapa, the tiniest of matter in the physical plane, is formed. In other words, the coexistence for a moment of these eight nature elements of behavior makes a mass just for that moment, which in Buddhism is known as kalapa. The size of a kalapa is about 1 over 46,656 part of a particle of dust from the wheel of a chariot in summer of India. The lifespan of a kalapa is a moment, there being a trillion such moments in the wink of an eye of a human being. These kalapas are all in a state of perpetual change or flux. To a developed student in Vipassana meditation, they can be felt as a stream of energy, The human body is not an entity as it seems to be, but a continuum of an aggregate of matter, rupa, with life force, nama, coexisting. To know that our very staff is composed of tiny kalapas, all in a state of change, is to know what is true of nature of change or decay. This nature of change or decay, anesa, occasioned by the continual breakdown and replacement of kalapas, all in a state of combustion, must necessarily be identified with dukkha only, the truth of suffering. It is only when you experience impermanence as dukkha that you come to the realization of the truth of suffering of the Four Noble Truths on which so much emphasis has been laid in the teaching of Buddha. Why? Because you realize this subtle nature of dukkha from which you cannot escape for a moment, you would become truly afraid of, disgusted with, and disinclined to your very existence with rupa and nama, and look out for a way to escape to a state beyond, that is beyond dukkha, and so to the end of suffering. What that end of suffering would be like, you will be able to have a taste of it, even so as a human being, when you reach the level of a sotapatti and is developed well enough by practice to go into the unconditioned state of peace of nibbana within. Be that as it may, for everyday life, no sooner than you are able to keep up the awareness of anesa in practice, you will know for yourself that a change is taking place in you, both physically and mentally, for the better. Before entering upon the practice of vipassana meditation, that is, after samadhi has been developed to a proper level, a student should first be acquainted with the theoretical knowledge of rupa, matter, and nama, mind and mental properties. If he has understood these well in theory and has come to the proper level of samadhi, there is every likelihood of his understanding anesa, dukkha and anatta in the true sense of the words of Buddha. In vipassana meditation, one contemplates not only upon the changing nature, anesa, of rupa or matter, but also upon the changing nature, anesa, of nama, that is, thought elements of attention projected towards the process of change of rupa or matter. At times, the attention will be on anesa of rupa or matter only. At times, the attention may be on anesa of thought elements, nama. When one is contemplating upon anesa of rupa or matter, one realizes also that the thought elements arising simultaneously with the awareness of anesa of rupa or matter are also in a state of transition or change. In that case, you are knowing anesa of both rupa and nama together. All I have said so far relates to the understanding of anesa through body feeling of the process of change of rupa or matter, and also of thought elements, depending upon such changing processes. You should know also that anesa can be understood through other types of feeling as well. Anesa can be developed through feeling, one, by contact of visible form with the sense organ of eye, two, by contact of sound with the sense organ of ear, three, by contact of smell with the sense organ of nose, four, by contact of taste with the sense organ of tongue, five, by contact of touch with the sense organ of body, six, by contact of thoughts with the sense organ of mind. In fact, one can develop the understanding of anesa through any of the six organs of sense. In practice, however, we have found out that of all the types of feeling, the feeling by contact of touch with the component parts of the body covers a wide area for introspective meditation. Not only that, the feeling by contact of touch by way of friction, radiation, and vibration of the kalapas within with the component parts of the body is more tangible than other types of feeling. And therefore, a beginner in vipassana meditation can come to the understanding of anicca more easily through body feeling of the nature of change of rupa or matter. This is the main reason why we have chosen the body feeling as a medium for quick understanding of anicca. It is open to anyone to try other means, but my suggestion is that one should have oneself well established in the understanding of anicca through body feeling before an attempt is made through other types of feeling. There are 10 levels of knowledge in vipassana, namely 1. Samasana, that is appreciation of anicca, dukkha and anatta by close observation and analysis, of course theoretically. 2. Udyavaya, that is knowledge of the arising and dissolution of rupa and nama. 3. Bhanga, that is knowledge of the fast changing nature of rupa and nama as a swift flow of current or a stream of energy. 4. Vaya, that is knowledge of the fact that this very existence is dreadful. 5. Adinava, that is knowledge of the fact that this very existence is full of evils. 6. Nibbida, that is knowledge of the fact that this very existence is disgustful. 7. Monjitu Kamyata, that is knowledge of the urgent need to escape from this very existence. 8. Patichanka, that is knowledge of the fact that time has come to work with full realization for salvation with anicca at the base. 9. Sankharupekha, that is knowledge of the fact that the stage is now set to get detached from sankhara and to break away from ego-centralism. 10. Anuloma, that is knowledge that would accelerate the attempt to reach the goal. These are the levels of attainments which one gets through during the course of vipassana meditation, which in the case of those who reach the goal in a short time, they can be known only in retrospect. With the progress in the understanding of anicca, one gets through these levels of attainment, subject, however, to adjustment or help at certain levels by a competent teacher. One should avoid to look forward to such attainments in anticipation, as this will distract him from the continuity of awareness of anicca, which alone can and will give him the desired reward. Let me now deal with vipassana meditation from the point of view of a householder in everyday life and explain the benefits one can derive from it here and now in this very lifetime. The initial object of vipassana meditation is to activate anicca in one's own self, or to experience one's own inner self in anicca, and to get eventually to a state of inner and outer calmness and balance. This is achieved when one becomes engrossed in the feeling of anicca within. The world is now facing serious problems threatening mankind. It is just the right time for everyone to take to vipassana meditation and to learn how to find a deep pool of quiet in the midst of all that is happening today. Anicca is in sight of everybody. It is with everybody. It is within reach of everybody. Just a look into his own self, and there it is, the anicca to be experienced. When one can feel anicca, when one can experience anicca, and when one can become engrossed in anicca, one can at will cut away from the wall of ideation outside. Anicca is for the householder, the gem of life, which he will treasure to create a reservoir of calm and balanced energy for his own well-being and for the welfare of the society. Anicca, when properly developed, strikes at the root of one's physical and mental ills and removes gradually whatever is bad in him, that is, the cause of such physical and mental ills. In the lifetime of Buddha, there were some 70 million people in Savatthi and places around in the kingdom of Pasenadi Kosala. Of them, about 50 million were arrears who had passed into the stream of Sotapatti. The number of householders who took to Vipassana meditation must therefore be more. Vipassana is not reserved for men who have renounced the world for a homeless life. It is for the householder as well. Now the time clock of Vipassana is struck. Now the time clock of Vipassana is struck. In spite of drawbacks which make householders restless in these days, a competent teacher or guide can help a student to get anicca activated in him in a comparatively short time. Once he got it activated, all that is necessary would be for him to try and preserve it. But he must make it a point, as soon as time or opportunity presents itself for further progress, to work out for the stage of Benga, the third level of knowledge in Vipassana. If he reaches this level, there will be little or no problem, because he should then be able to experience anicca without much ado and almost automatically. In this case, anicca shall become his base for the return thereto of all physical and mental activities outside the body as soon as the domestic needs of daily life for such activities are over. There is likely, however, to be some difficulty with one who has not as yet reached the stage of Benga. It will be just like a tug of war for him between anicca with him and physical and mental activities outside the body. So it would be wise for him to follow the motto of walk while you walk, play while you play. There is no need for him to be activating anicca all the time. It should suffice if this could be confined to the regular period or periods set apart in the day or night for the purpose. During this time, at least, attempt must be made to keep the mind attention inside the body with the awareness exclusively of anicca. That is to say, this awareness of anicca should be from moment to moment, or so continuous as not to allow for interpolation of any discursive or distracting thoughts which are definitely detrimental to progress. In case this is not possible, you would have to go back to respiration mindfulness, because samadhi is the key to anicca. To get good samadhi, sila has to be perfect, since samadhi is built upon sila. For good anicca, samadhi must be good. If samadhi is excellent, awareness of anicca will also become excellent. There is no special technique for activating anicca other than the use of mind set to a perfect state of balance and attention projected to the object of meditation. In Vipassana, the object of meditation is anicca, and therefore, in the case of those who are used to drawing back their attention to body feeling, they can feel anicca directly. In experiencing anicca on or in the body, it should first be in the area where one can easily get his attention engrossed, changing the area of attention from place to place, from head to feet, and from feet to head, at times probing into the interior. At this stage, it must be clearly understood that no attention is to be paid to the anatomy of the body, but right to the formation of matter, kalapas, and the nature of their constant change. If these instructions are observed, there will surely be progress, but the progress depends also on parami and the devotion of the individual to the work of meditation. As he attains higher levels of knowledge, his power to understand the three characteristics of anicca, dukkha, and anatta will also increase, and he will accordingly become nearer and nearer to the goal of arya, which every householder should keep in view. This is the age of science. Man of today has no utopia. He will not accept anything unless the results are good, concrete, vivid, personal, and here and now. When Buddha was alive, he said to the Kalamas, "Now look, you Kalamas, be not misled by report or tradition or hearsay. Be not misled by proficiency in the collections, nor by reason of logic, nor after reflection on and approval of some theory, nor because it conforms with one's inclination, nor out of respect for the prestige of a teacher. But Kalamas, when you know for yourselves, these things are unwholesome, these things are blameworthy, these things are censured by the intelligent, these things, when practiced and observed, conduce to loss and sorrow, then indeed do ye reject them. But if at any time you know of yourselves, these things are wholesome, they are blameless, they are praised by the intelligent, these things, when practiced and observed, conduce to welfare and happiness, then, Kalamas, do ye, having practiced them, abide therein." The time clock of Vipassana is now struck, that is, for the revival of Buddha Dhamma, the Vipassana in practice. We have no doubt whatsoever about definite results accruing to those who would, with open mind, sincerely undergo a course of training under a competent teacher. I mean results which will be accepted as good, concrete, vivid, personal, and here and now. The results which will keep them in good stead, in a state of well-being and happiness for the rest of their lives. May all beings be happy, and may peace prevail in the world.
Can you tell us something about the origin of the technique of Vipassana? When and where did it first appear, and how was it preserved over time?
Anyone who becomes a Buddha becomes Buddha with the practice of Vipassana. After becoming a Buddha using the practice of Vipassana, he gets fully liberated, and then out of infinite compassion he starts distributing it to others. For some centuries people follow it, the technique remains alive, and then slowly it gets lost. The word Vipassana remains with the human society, but the technique gets lost. This enlightened person, Gautama the Buddha, rediscovered this technique. The earlier Buddha also had practiced Vipassana, had taught Vipassana. Therefore, the word Vipassana was available in the society of those days, in the other scriptures of those days, but the practice was totally lost. Gautama the Buddha rediscovered it, distributed it, and then for about 5 centuries, it remained in its pristine purity in India, then it got lost here. It went to different countries. There also slowly it got lost, but one country, Burma, maintained it in its pristine purity from teacher to pupil, from teacher to pupil, and that is why we are getting it now in its pure form.
How did the technique actually go to Burma in the first place, and how was it maintained there? Specify Lady Sayadaw, Sayateji, Bebu Sayadaw, Sayajiv Bakhin.
It's a long history. Even before Buddha, a few centuries before Buddha, people of Sakyan clan had migrated from Kapilvastu to Burma and settled down there. So it is quite possible that these Sakyan people who got settled down in Burma, when they came to know that somebody from their clan has become an enlightened person, naturally they would have got interested in him. And that is how they might have come in contact with the teaching of Buddha. Some of them would have come to India, or people from India might have gone there. But that is something merely of presumption. The history of southern Burma says that a direct disciple of Gautama the Buddha, an arhant by the name of Kavampati, he came from a very wealthy family. His family was involved in big business, international business. His brother had gone and settled down in southern Burma, what is called Thaton today. And he established a city by the name of Suddhamavati and became a ruler of that particular area. When he came to know that his brother has become arhant, naturally he wanted to know what the teaching is which made him arhant. So he requested him to come to Burma. So Gavampati went to Burma, maybe at the time of Buddha, or maybe immediately after Buddha. And when somebody goes there and takes the teaching of Buddha, well, it won't be just the theoretical aspect of Buddha's teaching. Naturally, Buddha is Buddha because of the practice of Vipassana, so he must have taken with him Vipassana. That is how we feel that Vipassana started in Burma. And then there is recorded history that during the time of Ashoka, two arhants by the name of Sona and Uttara went to Burma, again taking the teaching of the Enlightened One, that means Vipassana. So in southern Burma, there was continuous practice of Vipassana from generation to generation. About 1,000 years back, there was a monk by the name of Arhant, and he was also an Arhant from southern Burma. He went to middle part of Burma, what is called Pagan now. And so people there are practicing a very corrupt form of Buddha's teaching. So he explained them Buddha's teaching in detail. And then he talked about this technique also. So the king was very much interested in the words of Buddha, the real words of Buddha in Pali language. And then he requested the entire Tripitaka from the king of the southern Burma. And there is a long story. The southern Burma king refused to give, and then he attacked and got those things. But actually this Arhant who was there, he not only taught the theory of Buddha's teaching, he taught practicing of Vipassana also. And the later part of his life, he again migrated to still upper Burma, near Mandle, what is now Sagaing, a hill there. And he stayed there, practicing Vipassana and teaching Vipassana to the people. From then onwards, this Sagaing hill had become a center of Vipassana meditation. From teacher to pupil, from teacher to pupil, people will go to this hill, learn this technique. It was not spread in the masses, but people were there who were practicing in every generation. Historically, the person who comes in limelight is Lady Sayadaw, the very renowned monk, a very learned monk. He thought that without practicing, merely the theory of Buddha's teaching will not help me. So he went to this Sagaing area, contacted the teacher of Vipassana of that time, learned from him, and then he started teaching this technique. Quite a large number of people, monks as well as householders, learned from him. And Sayataji was very much interested in practicing the meditation of samatha, that is concentration of mind, and meditation of vipassana, the purification of mind. He spent about 14 years of his life and learned this technique mainly from Lady Sayadaw and then started teaching. And from him, quite a few people learned, monks as well as householders, out of whom some started teaching, and Sayaji Ubakhin was one amongst them. This is how we have the recent history of Vipassana.
Webu Sayadaw, would you like to say something?
Webu Sayadaw learned the same technique, but we can't say from where. When Sayaji Ubakhin met him, and he came to know from Sayaji Ubakhin that Ubakhin is practicing this technique of Vipassana, he was amazed, because he had to work for years together in remote places in jungle and all to reach a certain stage, and he found a layman, a householder, having reached quite high in this technique, just remaining a householder. So we can't say either whether Webu Sayadaw developed this within himself, or he went to Sagai and got it. There is no historical background about it, but certainly he was practicing the same technique.
Can you tell us more about Sayaji Ubakhin?
Sayaji Ubakhin was an important government service servant, Accountant General of Burma. Then he became Director of Commercial Audit, a very responsible officer who was renowned for his integrity and renowned for his efficiency. These two qualities, he used to say that I got it from Vipassana, and then he started spreading this technique to the other staff of the government, and he helped the administration to come out of inefficiency and non-integrity, and that was a big achievement. He also started teaching Vipassana by establishing the center, International Meditation Center in Rangoon.
How did you first come in contact with Vipassana, and how did it affect your life?
I was a patient of very severe type of migraine, which could not be treated by the best doctors in my country, that is in Burma. I was born there. The attacks were so frequent, every fortnight I will have a very severe attack, and they were so severe that no painkiller would work. The doctors started giving morphine injection. From the age of 25 to the age of about 30, I kept on taking morphine injection, and the doctors were worried that I might become morphine addict. So they advised me to get myself treated outside in foreign countries, at least to come out of this morphine. I tried with the best doctors in Switzerland, in Germany, in England, in the United States, in Japan, but it was utter failure. Nobody could help me to come out of migraine, nor could they give any other alternative except morphine injection. When I returned, a friend of mine, a very good friend of mine, told me to go to Ubakhin and take a 10-day course, because migraine is nothing but a symptom of some other disease inside. This migraine in itself is not a disease. So he said, certainly, you have a lot of mental tension. And it was true. My life was full of tension, being involved in business so deeply, being involved in so many social organizations, having so much responsibility. The life was full of tension. So he said, perhaps this Vipassana might help you. That is how I came in contact with Sayaji Ubakhin and Vipassana, and it certainly helped me.
It did help you?
Certainly.
How did actually Vipassana affect your family life?
Well, at a very young age, I was so successful in my business life, in my social life, that the ego became so very much inflated, and I became such a short-tempered person, a very angry person. Everything must happen according to my wishes. Nobody should say or do anything against my wishes. And that made not only me miserable, but all the members of the family were very miserable, very unhappy. All my staff in the office was very unhappy. My workers in my factory very unhappy. And I also felt very bad when I shouted on somebody out of anger. Later on I repented. I should not have done that. Well, I harm so many persons. This is not the way of life. But I couldn't come out of it. On the other hand, I had been reading scriptures of my tradition, Gita, Upanishad. They are all full of the same teaching. You must learn equanimity, you must come out of craving, you must come out of aversion. Intellectually, I was understanding it. But how to come out of it? There was no way. Merely just contemplating will not help. There must be a way out of it. And fortunately, this became a blessing in disguise, the migraine disease which brought me to Vipassana. And I found this is applied Gita. This is what people have been teaching from ages, but nobody teaches how to practice it. And there is a practice. I was fascinated by the technique because this was the applied part of Dhamma which we have been learning from the very young age. And then when I found really it is giving results, such an angry person, my anger started diminishing. Such an ego-centered person, my ego started deflating. And on the other hand, I started generating love and compassion for others. I found the life so peaceful. My family members, they found a person who was feared by everybody, like a devil who has come in the house. Whenever I come, everybody starts trembling. Now there is something, he's going to shout on some reason or the other. If somebody makes a mistake, I will shout. There's an example in our literature that a ink pot is lying on the floor, and by mistake I kick it, and then I shout on others, "Is this the place to keep ink pot? You mad fellows!" I have to shout. Next day the ink pot is there. Somebody else has kicked them, and again I shout, "Mad fellow, you don't see there is an ink pot there?" I will shout in every situation. So this was the kind of habit which I was carrying, and coming out of that, it was such a changed life. My friends started finding that a changed person, how, why, what he has done. And when they came to know this technique, it has helped, given result, they started coming to the technique. And then I found it is not somebody's blessing that I got changed myself. It's the technique which has changed. It started changing others also. There were people who were very mad, not in anger, maybe in fear, maybe in passion, maybe in other things. So many impurities are there, and they started coming out of their impurities. Their life started changing. Oh, then it became so clear that this is a result-oriented scientific technique which has nothing to do with any kind of blind belief or dogma or anything, because it gives a result here and now. And this helped me, and this helped my family members, every member of my family. From the age of 5 years to the age of 80 years, everybody started practicing Vipassana, and the household was so peaceful. We didn't see, while we were in Burma, any quarrel. A big household, about 20-30 members, but there was never anybody even speaking with a loud voice. The whole atmosphere was so congenial just because of Vipassana. And people started giving example, well, look, these people in Vipassana, they are living such a peaceful life, and yet doing all the responsibility of a householder's life, not running away from that. So it attracted me, it attracted my family, it attracted the society, and people there started taking courses.
What were the circumstances that brought you to India, and how did you start teaching Vipassana? What year was this?
It was in 1969, and by that time I had been practicing Vipassana for 14 years. My parents came to India about a few years back, and my mother developed a kind of mental disease, full of tension, worries, because her children in Burma, she was always worried about us. the government policy had changed, the government had changed, and although we were not in any trouble, but many of the capitalists there were in big trouble. So she had a natural worry that what may happen to my children there, my sons and others. So it was very much, she was out of this worry. She developed this mental tension. And doctors here, the best psychiatrists, they couldn't help her. I knew that Vipassana will help. So I requested the Burmese government, with whom I had very good relations, in spite of the fact that all my industry and business had been taken over by them. And very kindly they issued me a passport, which in those days, it was not easy for a Burmese national to get a passport to go out. And thus I came to India to give a course to my mother specially, and also my father and other relatives here in India.
What happened after the first course?
Well, first course was very successful. Mother came out of her mental problem. Father was also very happy. Although both of them had taken a course in Burma with Seyaji, but they had lost the practice. Another 12 people who participated in the course, they were so benefited that the quality of Dhamma, ehi pasiko, come and see, they started talking to their own relatives, their friends, you come and see this technique, it is so good, it helped me, it will help you also. So the pressure was to have another course. So another course was there. And then another course. Like this, the Ganges of Dhamma started flowing in this country.
Can you tell us something about the establishment of Dhammagiri?
Those who had taken courses with me were eager to have a center established somewhere in India. And because most of the students were from Bombay, they wanted a center to be established around Bombay, somewhere near Bombay. One of them had visited Burma and had met Seyaji Ubakhin while he was alive. And Seyaji Ubakhin told him that, well, look, it is your responsibility to see that a center is established. We are going to then give courses, more serious courses, having better effect, better results. So this person, plus a few more students, they started looking for places where a center can be established. But any suitable place around Bombay was not available. A course was given in Nasik, and one of the wealthy students who was there, when he came to know that a center is necessary and we are looking for a center, he went with me and showed me some places in Nasik, but that was not very suitable. So as we were returning to Bombay in his car, a student of ours from Igatpuri stopped the car, and we went to his house, took tea, and when he came to know that we are looking for a center, he said, well, there is a good place here also, and we came here, and it looked so wonderful, so good. This person, when he came to know who is the owner of this land, and he came to know where his address is, this person was in Bombay. So when he took me to Bombay, I went to the house, my house, but he didn't go to his own house. He went to the owner of this land and asked him what's the price. And this person said, a big amount, 85,000 rupees, which was so much, because actual price of the land in those days here was just 1,000 per acre. And it was 17,000. He said 85,000. He took out his checkbook and gave 75,000. And 85,000, and got receipt from him. And that's how this land came for Dhamma purpose. And later on, more land was purchased round about.
Can you tell us what is taught in a 10-day course? And specify why 10 days are necessary?
Well, the teaching is Sila, Samadhi, Panya, to live a life of morality, to concentrate the mind with the object of respiration, and then to practice Vipassana, to develop your own wisdom, your own panya, and come out of the impurities of the mind, to purify the mind. About, say, 100 years back, or even 70 years back, the tradition was that a Vipassana course should be for 7 weeks, then only people can understand and can experience the depth of this technique. But then, as the modern age started the fast life started. Such people like me, a business person can never go for a course for 7 weeks. They started reducing the time. From 7 weeks they made it 1 month, and then they reduced it to 20 days, to 15 days. And when they came to 10 days, they found people get just an outline of this technique, not that depth which they used to get by 7 weeks course. But less than that, when they started making it for 7 days and all, they found it a waste of time. So a decision was made that a course should not be less than 10 days. And this 10-day course is started because of that.
Why is it so important that courses are financed only by donations from students who have then taken a course?
Well, this is a very healthy tradition from the past, and it is to keep the technique pure. By taking donation from our students, we are obliging them. We are obliging them that, look, we are accepting your donation and helping you to earn merits, to develop merits. But as soon as a non-meditator starts giving donation and we accept it, then he obliges us. Well, look, I am giving you this money. So things must be done in this way or that way. He will start bossing. Quite possible someday he will say, take these two people in the course. And look, they can't agree to all your discipline and all that. Keep them away from discipline. He may send somebody who might be drinking here. He may send somebody who might not practice but do something else here. This is dangerous. When a student gives, he gives out of a volition that Dhamma should spread. And with that volition, he can't come and boss. He will be very happy to come and serve only. So the tradition is maintained in its pristine purity just because the donation is received as a symptom, a symbol of gratitude from the student to the tradition of Dhamma.
Why don't you promote Vipassana through advertisement so that masses of people will come to know about it? Why is the emphasis on not on word of mouth? On word of mouth.
Well, word of mouth is the word of real experience. Somebody experiences and tells others, well, I have experienced it, it's so good. But when we start advertising by these medias, then it becomes more a commercial publicity. And it won't have that effect. And moreover, we have our own limitation. These courses are residential courses, and there must be facility for people to stay and practice. From the time we started working, we have found, say, this center, Dhammagiri, whatever facility we had is always full. And as the facility grows, more people come. If more people come and there is no facility, what's the use of this calling people by publicity? So as much people as they come by words of mouth, the facility is available, and that much is good enough. And like the slow widening of the circle is again the purity of it.
Why Vipassana is taught in prisons, and how did it all start?
Well, people in prison are miserable, but this does not mean that those who are outside prison are not miserable. People outside also are prisoners of their own behavior pattern, and Vipassana helps people to come out of prison, to come out of bondage. So far as giving courses in the prisons is concerned, you might have heard about a saintly person of this country who has passed away, Vinoba Bhave. When I met him coming from in Burma after 2 or 3 years, and we were discussing about Vipassana, he said, I will accept the efficacy of the technique only if it is proved in the jail working with the very hard criminals, or it is proved with students in the schools. I said, I am here to serve. If you can arrange, I will teach the hard criminals in the jail. I will teach the students. He arranged in the school and it was very successful. But he could not arrange in the prison because the rules of prison, manual of prison is such that a teacher cannot go and stay there. One has to stay outside, and that was not acceptable to me. When a course is given, I must be there with my students. It could not materialize. But later on, the Rajasthan government was good enough to relax their rules, and the first course was given there in the Jaipur jail. And like this, the ball started rolling. And then, since then, many courses in many prisons have been given.
Why is it important to teach meditation to children?
Well, it is a way of life, a good way of life, and at this age one should learn so that they can live a very peaceful life, very happy life, very harmonious life. This is the age when they are learning so many things, and this art of living should also be learned at that age.
You keep mentioning that the technique is scientific. Most people would regard meditation as religious or spiritual. Would you comment on this?
Well, because most of the meditation techniques can be called religious, spiritual, because sectarianism is involved in that. But so far as Vipassana is concerned, there is no sectarianism involved. You can't call it a religion. There is no dogma. There is no blind faith. It is really pure science, a science of the interaction of mind and matter. One has to experience the truth about oneself at the level of mind and matter, how this interaction is going on, how the mind keeps on influencing the matter, how the matter keeps on influencing the mind, and how currents, cross-currents, undercurrents are going inside. Because of the ignorance of all that, one keeps on generating negativities, and because of these negativities, one becomes miserable. And this negativity keeps on multiplying. By this technique, one stops the multiplication of these negativities and starts eradicating the negativities. The entire behavior pattern starts getting changed. So this is pure science of mind and matter. We can't call it religion. It's nothing to do with any sect, because everyone from any religion, from any tradition, can practice it and will get the same result.
What is the meaning of the word Dhamma?
Well, Dhamma means nature, characteristic, the truth about nature. Dhamma means law. So we can say Dhamma means the truth about the law of nature, the universal law of nature.
There are people who have the impression that meditation is an escape from reality. But you call it an art of living. Can you elaborate on this?
Maybe certain techniques or certain other way of meditation might be called an escape. But so far as Vipassana is concerned, it is certainly not an escape. It is to live a life. One has got so much responsibility as a householder. One should be able to perform all those responsibilities in a proper way. You are not running away from your responsibilities. But you have to learn how to fulfill your responsibilities. It is not an escape, it is not running away. You take your meals twice or thrice in a day, and at that time your other activities are stopped. It's not escape. You're not running away from your activities. You have to make your body healthy to work. You take physical exercises. You walk. You run to keep your body healthy. And at that time, you can't do any other work. This is not an escape. You are making yourself physically strong so that you can work properly. Similarly, this is a mental exercise. You come to a course to learn this technique, and then daily you practice morning and evening so that you can apply it in your life. You practice 1 hour in the evening, 1 hour in the morning, just to make the mind healthy, wholesome, strong, pure, so that you can work properly. It's a way of life. No escape is involved in it.
If the purpose of meditation is to become detached from worldly affairs, then what relevance does it have to the modern values of efficiency, materialism and achievement?
Well, a good question. Understand, the attachment is actually not an attachment towards the worldly things. When you go deep inside, you will find that the real attachment is attachments towards your own ego, I. Everything else is to fulfill the desire of this I, to satisfy this I. Vipassana takes you out of this attachment towards your own I, ego, a false imaginary I, and tremendous amount of attachment towards it keeps one so very much unbalanced in life. So when you come out of this attachment, this does not mean that you will run away from your responsibilities of day-to-day life. Actually, your capacity to work will increase. Attitude will change. Previously, whatever you were working, the whole idea of working hard was to gain something for the satisfaction of your ego. Your ego was important. Satisfaction of your ego was important. Now, what important will be that you are working not only for your own good, but for the good of others also. Look, whatever I am doing, it is also helpful to others. So your capacity to work will increase, the attitude to life will change, and you will find it is so healthy, it will be so wholesome. You can live a very peaceful, harmonious life within, and you will generate nothing but peace and harmony for others.
You give so much importance to morality as the foundation of this technique. But isn't morality another form of dogmatism?
In Dhamma, there cannot be any dogmatism. If we had been teaching Dhamma by giving sermons, oh, people of the world, you should not kill, you should not steal, you should not do this, perhaps it would have been just a dogmatism. You believe because your teacher says so. You believe because your scripture says so. Your tradition says so. But here it is not so. When you practice Vipassana, you understand that whenever you perform any unwholesome action, say you kill somebody, you can't kill somebody without generating tremendous amount of anger or hatred in you. You steal something, you can't steal something without generating tremendous amount of craving or greed. Similarly, any physical or vocal action which is unwholesome, which goes against morality, which is immoral, starts with an impure mind, a negative mind. And every time one generates negativity in the mind, impurity in the mind, one becomes miserable. That one starts realizing. So again, this is a law of nature, that when I harm others, I can't harm anybody without first harming myself. This is pure science, law of nature. No dogmatism is involved.
What is your message to the world?
The message to the world is to come out of dogmatism. Learn Dhamma as a way of life. Everyone in the world wants to come out of misery. Nobody wants to live a life of misery. Everyone wants to come out of unhappiness, wants to live a peaceful, happy life. But how to live? These sensual pleasures here, there, can make one happy for some time. But then again, the misery starts. As soon as you miss it, the misery starts. Well, there is a way, and a very scientific way, that in every situation, you can live so peacefully and so harmoniously within, and then you can generate peace and harmony to fulfill the entire atmosphere around you, so that people who come in contact with you, they also start living a life of peace and harmony. Nothing like that. So this is for the good of one. This is good for everybody. Everyone in the world wants peace and harmony, and mere sermons won't help. There must be a technique for that. Here is a technique which was lost to the world, to the human beings, last 20 centuries, now that it has come up. Make use of it and enjoy peace, enjoy harmony.
Thank you.
Be happy.